And then 1941, November, we went into the attack against Rommel, Sidi Rezaq area. First, we cut the wire on the border of Libya, Egypt. I'll never forget, we were sent out that night to cut the wire. We didn't know how many mines, how many machine guns there were. Our army was back, all the armor, all the artillery, we were sent to cut through the wire, about 40 feet, concrete, landmines. We had to cut through this lot. I tell you, I said my prayer about 40 times that night. I didn't know how to pray. You know, a sinner doesn't know how to pray. You only pray when death comes. True, only time you pray is in a crisis hour when you feel, I am going to meet God. I am responsible. We cut through the wire, tore it open about 6 o'clock as the sun came out. We broke through our army and we were in the desert going towards Sidi Rezaq. And Rommel had his planes up and they took our photos and they pinned us down with their Messerschmitt 109s. They were coming out the sun that morning. Every few minutes there was one tearing down the desert at a low altitude, blasting our trucks, and the bombers were coming, blowing from the top. I tell you, that's not easy. As the trucks, we were 14 in, stacked with ammunition, petrol, anti-tank bombs, and these Messerschmitts to come out the sun, you cannot see them. So we sat stripped outside with machine guns pointing in the direction of the sun, and all the Bofors and anti-tank machine guns. And as they came down, we shot down quite a few. Then the bombers would come. Eventually, 21, 22, 23 November, Sidi Rezaq came. Well, I tell you, General Smut said it was about even with Calvert Wood, so it was a terrific area with a terrific impact of destruction. It was a terrific day, 23rd of November. We had battles for days coming onto escarpments, blowing the tanks, planes are coming over. Our men were dying, they were blown to pieces, the trucks were blasted. But on the 23rd of November was the crisis day. We fought from sunrise till dark that night, continuous. They were blasting us. We were cut off. Our ammunition, our water supply, our ammunition were cut off by the armored panzer divisions of Rommel. We were outnumbered. We were stretched too far forward. They made a mistake. They sent us too far forward, so they cut us off in the back. And we were battling tanks and the 88 millimeter German guns were blasting us. It was raining, and the Bofors were over us, the planes. And that night, as sun was setting, it was a burning hell. German tanks, German dead, South Africans, New Zealanders, Australians, and we were fighting hand to hand. And I knew this was the end. People were surrendering, others were being killed, the Germans were crying. It was a terrific scene. It looked like a burning hell. And I knew if I had to die, I would be lost. Eventually, we fought with machine guns hand to hand, and they were blasting us against the trucks. And the trucks were burning, and the dead were screaming, "Mate! Mate! Help!" We couldn't get near. Nobody could help. Nobody. You had just had a battle for yourself. And as it was getting dark, they were blasting us with tracer bullets, and I was against the truck. And a volley came towards my way, hit the truck right the back of me. I thought, well, I'm cut to pieces. But it didn't happen. I felt, man, no, I'm still in one. I never realized what really happened. When I came back, my mom said that night, God woke her up. She started to pray for hours. And God put his hand around me as protecting me, because the power of prayer is so great. The power of God is so real, so great. God didn't allow me to die. He had a reason for it. There was prayer to be answered. And then we had either to surrender or fight through the barrier. The Germans had a barrier of tanks and guns and machine gunners. And we either had to make a decision. So all the trucks were burning. We got a colored man from one of these 18-inch, that's all you could dig is 18-inch just to get away from the shrapnel. And we got him out, got him behind a good truck, Pitchford and I. And we said, listen, we're going to break through somehow. Well, he had his ammunition and gun on the other side. I was standing this side. I was refusing to surrender. And unfortunately, we ran into a German column. And they started to blast us. We turned left and we got a Crusader, British Crusader tank. Their ammunition were going out, but their machine gun was still going. And the officer said, come on, follow us. And we were running through the Germans. And they were blasting a hole into the defense. And eventually they put the machine guns on us. And we hit the ditch and the truck turned on its left side. Picked up its right back leg. And I was somewhere in the air. When I came down, Pitchford, the truck and everybody was gone. Luckily, this friend of mine stopped it was like suicide. But he stopped the truck and said, I'm going to find my friend. We were great pals. And he went back. I was still alive. I got in the truck and we broke through. And got through to Donnie Pienaar's troops right on the hill on the other side. The British Crusader took out his radio and he contacted the troops and we got to Donnie Pienaar, General Donnie Pienaar, and he was blasting the German tanks. That's how it went. I had to cut some of the things out because the most important is to come. And at the Alamein, we were at Suez taking off trucks and guns for battle. And we were ducked in next to the oil refinery. And the Germans couldn't come in over the harbor because of the balloons with steel wire. So they had to come over the mountain. And that night they came over, the sirens were going, the lights were up, but they came over so fast. And they dropped 11 bombs right on the oil refinery, just next to it where we were ducked in. And we came out the canteen, because I was a sinner, I had a drink with my friend. And as we came out the canteen, a British sergeant major, a British officer, and myself, we just come out the canteen, the others were still in there. 11 bombs dropped right on top of us. When a bomb is far off, you can hear the shriek, the spine, but when it comes close, it's like a rushing wind. I knew this is it. But somehow God provided that I dived into a shallow trench. I skinned all my sides. The sergeant major was cutting off. The British soldier was blown right through his heart. The canteen was blown like a tea tray. People's flesh was sticking on the side. And as I came out of that mess, I thought, my God, I'm still alive. I'm still alive. I said a little prayer. I don't know what I said. That's how it started. But in 42, beginning 43, I came home on the Nova Scotia. British ship. We had troops on it and American soldiers. We put them off at Massawa, North Africa. We took on prisoners of war and we went home to South Africa. After I'd been over 2 years in the front line, and I came home, Nova Scotia. And we were 18 days on the water. No escort because everybody was fighting for survival. There was no escort. But we were turning in the water like this with outfits all over looking from submarines with our gunners and our depth charges. We were on guard all the time with the prisoners down in the bottom singing their opera music. That's how it went. But at night it was dark. But the 18th day of the morning, we were 500 miles from Durban, 180 miles from the Ranger Mark, in that dangerous area at Madagascar. It's very cold in the Indian Ocean. And 12 minutes past 9, I know I was coming from second deck up. There was just a shout. I heard it. They call the nest up there where the officers are with the telescopes. And the ship turned, but it was too late. There was a captain, Robert Geiser. He had sunk 12 ships. He was one of the best submarine captains of the last war. He had waited for a few days for our ship, and he saw a little dot on the horizon. He sank in the sea, but the sea was rough. It was choppy and white. And they were waiting for that moment. And as we came about 1,000 yards or meters from the submarine surface, but his telescope was out, and they saw it, but it was too late. He had targeted us, put his buttons on, and he sent 3 torpedoes. We only needed one, but he made sure, so he sent 3. The first one lifted the ship, turned its belly into an inferno. Second one ripped it open. Third one, I knew nothing. I was turning in the air from one side of the ship to the other. I got the railing from the side, and as I survived, I ripped off my shirt and the shoes that I have. I just had a little short pants on. And as I looked back, the ship was on its side with its nose in, burning, sucking oil, people blown to pieces, dead all over. And I thought, well, if I have to do something, it'll have to be fast.